Test.
Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Our first hymn this morning is "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing," an old Wesley hymn.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the trials of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, the honors of thy name.
His name is Jesus.
Jesus, the name that charms our fear, that bids our sorrows cease. His music in the sinner's ear, his life and health and peace.
He breaks the power.
He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed for me.
Sing that again. He breaks.
He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed. And listening to his voice, new life the dead receive. The mournful broken hearts rejoice, the humble poor believe. Hear him, my death is praise become, your loosened tongues employ.
Will you please bow with me? Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, how wonderful it is to be in your house this morning, to be worshiping the one and only true God. We stand amazed that you're thinking about us. It seems that we would be no more than an ant to cross your thoughts. You have so much you must have to think about, but instead you have made us important in your thoughts, important enough to love, to take care about, and to make a special place for in heaven. You know that we are full of fear and anxiety about our future, but you have sent your only Son into the world to bring us peace and hope and chase all fears away. You sent us your Holy Spirit so that we may have a comforter. When we think we are all alone, we must discover that you have not left us alone and you are always there. Help us to learn not to fear. Help us to not be afraid. Your holy and living word teaches us that if we repent our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You give us a brand new clean slate to begin our lives again with. How wonderful is that? Teach us to depend on your always living word and upon your always open arms. And that salvation we will find in our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For it's in his name that we pray. Amen. If you will Turn with me back to the screen again as we go to our responsive reading from Psalms 140. We keep moving through the book of Psalms, and please follow along with me, verses 12 and 13. I know that the Lord will maintain the cause of the afflicted. Surely the righteousness shall give thanks unto the unto thy name. Amen. I praise him this morning. Jesus, amen. That's a new one for the kids.
We're on the course to follow you all our days. Knowing, of course, that God is good always, always. You know me, love me, I trust you with my life. Your word, yes, shows me a little bit more each day.
That's what we have to do. We've got to be all in this. Our memory verse this morning from Romans 5:19. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. That's a very, very important promise that we have from Romans 5:19. Amen. Good morning to all of you this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I see that everybody survived the flood. It was terrible out here. We even found a road that was still flooded on our way from our house this morning, but we managed to get here, and the floodwaters are receding, but boy, it was terrible on Thursday. And I just want to thank God we got all the kids picked up with a bus and got back here and got them all home. But the school buses turned around and headed back through the barn with kids in them because it was pretty nasty. So it's good to see everyone here this morning. Sun's shining. You know, it's the middle of February, and I checked the weather for this week, and it's going to be in the 50s again. Now, if this is global warming, I'm not going to fuss too much. But I don't think that it is. I think it's just the way the jet stream is and that we've had other winters like this before. But praise the Lord that's there. Tuesday evening, 6:30, we have Bible study and prayer meeting, and we really need that time for the church. So if we want to thank those that are watching at home as well, and I appreciate you for taking this time to watch us, whether you're going to watch us on Armstrong or through the stream or whether you're going to watch us on the internet, we're glad to have you with us this morning. And I want to make sure Thursday after school, our Kid Fusion program, we're going strong with that. Have some new kids in that program, and they're going to look for some other children too. And on Wednesday, we've got so many kids in our Thursday program that we actually decided to have a teen program, right? Start a teen club from the seventh grade above. So if you're watching and you have kids in school, they can either find a place out here on Wednesday after school. They come out, they do their homework first and get some help with homework. And then if they need it, and then have all kinds of other things to do. So they can come out here on Wednesday if they're seventh grade and above, and they can come out here Thursday if they're not. And we have a lot of opportunities out there. I want to let you know that we're having a 16-minute video, I can either show you the video and not preach, or I can preach and show you the video after. And so I'm not going to let you have a vote because I'm afraid what the vote would be. No, I know you guys want me to preach. So we'll have that video. And you can stay if you want. I think that you'll enjoy it. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit in my sermon. I also want to talk about something that happened this week. I was asked to go to the Crawford County Correctional Institute and to do a pastoral visit with someone that's in there, and I went, and there wasn't a policy. I'm surprised, but for 22 years or the length of time out there, they haven't allowed pastors to walk in there and I've been doing this for 33 years, and I've never met with that, so I immediately went to the warden and went to the district attorney and went to a judge and went and hired an attorney and went to our state representative and went even to the sheriff, and nearly everybody thought that it was strange that there wasn't a policy for that, and I was told that there couldn't be a policy for that, and I think that really wise, cool, smart heads prevailed over between Thursday and Friday, and I got a call Friday morning from the warden who said that the clergy now is listed with the other list of professionals at Crawford County and can go in and see their parishioners. I'm real happy. But I'm also embarrassed that nobody has tried to make that distinction for the last 22 years. I don't know, but those people that are over there really, really do, you know, need their pastors, and they need some pastors coming over, and that. So I want to thank the warden. I want to thank Kathy Rupp and our district attorney and all of those who got together and helped make that a new change. So I'm again I just want to thank everybody. So if you see them on the street, say thanks, and we'll move on. It's good that we can come together and work for the betterment of our community, even when things have been that way for 22. You know, I've always been that way. It doesn't always make it the right way. So anyway, now we got a new treat because our kids are gonna come up and play the chimes for our teen program. Come on. They have they've been practicing and practicing, and they've got this song that they want to practice for or play for you. Second verse. Really good job. Really good job. Any praises this morning? I'm sure that's a praise for all of us to be here, that we're not buried in snow. I told somebody I was, you know, as hard as it was that we had all that rain on Thursday, I'm thankful that it wasn't snow. We'd all still be digging out around here. So we have praises, people, besides all the kids getting home and all kinds of wonderful things. I guess I want to talk about my praise for this week with what happened out at the Correctional Institute, because we've had somebody that we've been praying for a long time, and that person has, over the years, has professed to have a real, real dislike for me. So it was quite interesting, I guess, to have a social worker come and say that she had asked for my card and wanted to see me. I didn't know when I got there whether I was going to be cussed out or what. But the first thing she wanted to know was that with all the bad things that she's done, could God save her? And a person that, even though she's had a difficult time with me in the past, the person that she knew that she could trust to have give her the right answer was me, and that's who she wanted to talk to. I'm grateful because we've paid for this person for many years, her and her family. God does answer prayer. I'm going to preach a little bit about what's going on in the world. But when you get tied up on drugs and alcohol and all kinds of things in the world, the only real way out of that is through the Lord Jesus Christ. She went into jail, and first thing she did was got into a fight and got handcuffed and locked down into solitary. She no sooner got out of that and got into a second fight. Somebody from the church here had sent a Bible over to her, and she didn't know where the Bible came from. But being locked away for all that time, the only thing she had was her Bible. And she read it with tears in her eyes. She had questions that she wanted answered. I just praise the Lord that he works in such wonderful, wonderful ways. And so we want to continue to pray that we continue on. I guess I'll be going over there and doing counseling and some other things and talking. And I pray that she'll continue to move her life in the right direction. But I praise God for that being allowed and able to make happen. Sometimes it gets to be sad to be the pastor when you know you're going through tough weather and everything, and not a lot of people come to the church. But I will tell you that this morning I came to church, and I had another praise as I came to church, and Gene and Linda, who are usually here, were struggling getting here late, and I started worrying. So I came and I opened everything up, and lo and behold, somebody, some wonderful person, had put a $20 bill in the front door. And I opened the front door and the $20 bill fell out. It's in the offering plate this morning, but somebody's watching us at home, and I praise the Lord. Thank you so much for sending it. We can always use that because we're struggling with our bus these days and all the other things that's going on. But we're gonna keep moving forward. We're not gonna let anything drag us down. Any other praises this morning? God working marvelous, wonderful, miraculous things in your life. How about prayer requests? We want to keep Ron. Ron's going this week?
Friday.
This week for eye surgery. Is he going for eye surgery?
Well,
to check up with this. Yeah, okay. So Ron's going Friday. And so we want to keep Ron in prayer. Rick's back in church. They got moved, and I'm glad to see Rick because I know he's been struggling for the last couple of weeks with the weather and his breathing and his cold, so good to have Rick in. Yes, Mike.
My sister's having surgery on her ear.
Your okay. Anyone else? Yes, Bill. Pardon? Okay, yeah, Casey
and Brett
and Natalie are all sick, so we'll pray for all of those that are sick. Yes, Jacob.
My sister Amanda,
okay. Anyone else this morning? Yes, Abby.
My grandmother.
Grandmother, okay. And anyone else? Okay, pray for your mom and dad. Yes, and I encourage anybody that wants counseling to come on in and see us here. All right, yes.
My brother finally got home from the hospital yesterday.
Oh, praise the Lord.
It's been a month for him.
Uh-huh. All right. Well, that's...
I hope he stays home.
Yes. Okay, well, praise the Lord. All right, that's an answer to prayer, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. All right, Sarah?
I hope my continues to get better.
Okay. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the miracles that you put in front of us. I thank you for the miracles that we've had this week. I thank you for the people that help contribute here to the church, even if they aren't here on Sunday, those that watch us and who provide us with a little support. We ask you to continue to be with this church and help us to grow. We continue to ask you to watch over this country as we get ready to change the presidency, and we have a big day scheduled for Friday. We just ask you to continue to keep us as a Christian nation that will reach around the world and watch over and be able to spread the gospel to all the people of this world. We ask you to be with our military that's serving. And now Now we have military that's serving on the eastern in the eastern areas of Poland and the Baltic states. And we ask you to be with those who have been newly deployed, those in Afghanistan and in Iraq and in Syria and all the other places that they are in. We ask you to be with their families as well, to watch over them who are waiting for their loved ones to return. We ask you to be with all of our policemen and our firemen and our doctors and nurses and all of those who provide care for each and every person and for all of us in this country. We ask you to be with Ron and his appointment on Friday. We know that the weather's supposed to be good and that he'll be able to get down for his appointment. And Lord, we just ask you for a good report, a good response that will fix his eye this time. We ask you to be with Mike's sister who's going to surgery. We ask you to be with all of those who are still out sick, Casey, Brett, Natalie, and Dee Dee, and all the others that are not here that are out sick. And we ask you to be with Amanda. We ask you to be with Belle's mom and dad. And Lord, we just continue to ask you to watch over all of our children, to guide them and lead them, and to be with all of those who provide care for them, that watch over them, that they will keep them healthy and safe and strong. We thank you for the answered prayer for Michelle and the new baby, Austin. And we ask you to be in their lives as well and to watch over them. And again, we thank you for taking care of them as that delivery was this week. I thank you for being with me as I challenged the powers to be this week and got made changes for all of the clergy in this community. We just ask you to continue to bless the mission of this church, to help us to continue to grow and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to all the people around us. And we ask all these things in the name of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Sing of my Redeemer.
I forgot to tell you during the announcement, so I'll just make it now while you're going to your Bibles to Romans 6, 1 through 5. Romans 6, 1 through 5. My sermon is titled, Tickle My Ears, Please. Because I think that's what we want to do most of the time when we come to church. We want our ears tickled. I just want to make sure that you guys know, everybody knows that next Sunday we'll have potluck and all the kids. We didn't have puppets this month, but we're going to have a birthday party for everybody who had a birthday in January. We'll have that potluck next Sunday. Romans 6, 1 through 5. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ as raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. We discovered in chapter 5 of Romans that sin has come through the headship of Adam, and that sanctification comes through the headship of Christ. Because of the natural headship of Adam, sin was imputed to the human family. But there is another head of the human family, and that is Christ. He brings life and righteousness. He removes the guilt of sin from us. And on that basis, he can move into the lives of those who trust in him and begin to make them righteous. That is, he can begin to make them good. Now, here in chapter 6, we begin with sanctification. That's a difficult one for many people, and I'll try to fix that so that you understand that completely by the time we get done. But let me say a word about the matter of sanctification. There is a difference between justification and sanctification. These are two words from the Bible that you need to get acquainted with. There is a difference between merely being saved from sin and being made the type of person we should be because we are separated unto God. Justification is the foundation on which all the superstructure of sanctification rests. Now let me put it like this. Justification is an act. Sanctification is a work. Justification took place the moment you trusted Christ, you were declared righteous. The guilt was removed. Then God began to work in you. That will continue throughout your life. I believe in instantaneous salvation, but sanctification is a lifelong process. In other words, justification is the means and sanctification is the end. Justification is for us. Sanctification is in us. Justification declares the sinner righteous. Sanctification makes the sinner righteous. Justification removes the guilt and penalty of sin. Sanctification removes the growth and the power of sin. God is both an exterior and an interior decorator. He is an exterior decorator in that he enables us to stand before him because he has paid the penalty and removed the guilt of sin from our lives. We stand before him in the power and presence of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ. But he is also an interior decorator. He moves into our hearts and lives by the power of the Holy Spirit to make us the kind of Christians we should be. God does not leave us in sin when he saves us. both, Bill, both justification and sanctification flow from being in Christ, crucified and risen. The subject of this chapter is the ability of God to make sinners whom he has declared righteous actually righteous. He shows that the justified sinner cannot continue in sin because he died and rose again in Christ. To continue in sin leads to slavery to sin and is the additional reason for not continuing in sin. I always think about this when I think about doing in my counseling with people who have done alcohol and or drug recovery. The fact is that they've allowed themselves to become a slave to their addiction and a slave to sin. And the only way out of that is to turn to Christ. The believer has a new nature now, and he is to obey God. This section delivers us from the prevalent idea today that a believer can do as he pleases. Union with Christ in his death and resurrection means that he is now our Lord and Master. He gives us freedom, but that freedom is not license to do as we will. Paul here is being argumentative. For in the Greek, the question is always asked in such a way that there is only one answer. He proceeds the question is with, what shall we say then? After you see God's wonderful salvation, what can you say to it? Our only fitting response is, hallelujah. What else can you say to God's wonderful salvation? Now, Paul's argumentative question is this. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? The answer is, God forbid, or perish the thought, or may it never be. Paul continues on in Romans 6:2, it says, and uses the term, God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? The very fact that Paul is asking this question makes it obvious that he understood justification to mean a declaration of righteousness, that it did not mean to make a person good, but to declare a person good. Justification means that the guilt of or the penalty of sin is removed, but not the power of sin in our day-to-day lives. He is going to talk about removing the power of sin. If God has declared you to be righteous and has removed the guilt of your sin, then you cannot continue in sin. The answer is, God forbid. We die to sin in Christ, but we are never dead to sin. Any honest person knows he never reaches the place where he is dead to sin. He does reach the place where he wants to live for God and for Jesus Christ, but he recognizes he still has that old sin nature. It is verses like that that have led groups and persons to believe that they have reached an exalted plane where they do not commit sin and that pastors do not need to preach about sin. The Joel Osteen Victorious Life Movement and Rick Warren's Purpose Driven are such movements. We died to sin in Christ. That's our position, but we are never dead to sin in this life. You have a sinful nature. I have a sinful nature, and we'll have it as long as we have this life. When Christ died almost 2,000 years ago, that is when we, as born-again, Bible-believing Christians, died. We died in him, and we were raised in him, and we are joined now to a living Christ. This is that great truth. I don't know about you, but I'm not able to crucify myself. The very interesting thing is that you can kill yourself in a variety of ways. By poisoning with a gun, by jumping off a building, but you cannot crucify yourself. Maybe you can drive the nails into one hand on the cross, but how are you going to fasten the other hand to the cross? You cannot do it. If we believe in Christ, we joined with him and were crucified nearly 2,000 years ago when Christ died. Know ye not that So many of us, as we're baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death. This, again, is a verse that has been misunderstood. If you find water in this verse, you have missed the meaning. And what Paul means here is identifying with Christ. We were baptized or identify with unto his death. In 1 Corinthians, Paul says, "For by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body." Now, Paul is going to say that there are three things essential to our sanctification. Two of them are personal, and one of them is very, or two of them are positional, and one of them is very practical. For the two that are positional, we are to know something. Every gadget that you buy has instructions with it. When I buy a gadget, I take it out of the box, and I try to follow the instructions for assembling it. And I know people that, and friends of mine, sometimes they call me over to read the instructions, and I find out that they've tried to put something together that doesn't look like even what's on the front of the box, because they tried to do it without putting the using the directions. And I'm sure that's happened to a lot of people. But Christ has given us a set of directions. Well, living the Christian life is such an important thing that it also comes with instructions. There are certainly things we are required to know. We are to know that when Christ died nearly 2,000 years ago, we, born again, Bible-believing Christians, were identified with him. Let me make it personal. Nearly 2,000 years ago, they led me outside of an oriental city by the name of Jerusalem. I stood on Golgotha. I stood up and looked up at the cross, and I was the one who was guilty. He was not guilty. My sin put him up there. We were identified with Jesus Christ. That is something that we should know. And it is very important for us to know. We're identified with him. Now, Paul will amplify this. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. We are buried with him by baptism into death. Just as we are identified with Christ in his death, likewise we are identified with Christ in his resurrection. We are joined today to a living Christ. In other words, our sins have already been judged. We are already raised, and we are up yonder seated with Christ in the heavenlies. There are only two places for your sins. Either they are on Christ when he died for you over 2,000 years ago because you have trusted him as your Savior, or they are on you today, and judgment is ahead for you. There is no third place for our sins to be. We are buried with him by baptism or identification into his death. This is the reason a child of God should be baptized in water in our day. It is a testimony that he is joined to the living Christ. That is all important. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. In other words, if we are united by being grafted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also united by growth, grafted, vitally connected in the likeness of his resurrection. But it's more than vitally, because the branch that is not grafted in or connected withers and dies, because the living, growing material comes only from the vine or the tree. The branch has no living in itself. We actually share the life of Christ somewhat as a limb grafted onto a tree shares the life of the tree. The life of Christ is our life now. We have no life force of our own. Now, I do not know many pastors these days trying to teach these things. Number one, they're hard to teach in any way that people can or want to understand them. Most people just don't want to hear such things. I wish they did and would fill this place up. But I could fill this place up if I stopped preaching hard truths and the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ and started preaching about a way that tickled people's ears. I told you about my run-in with the powers here at Crawford County this week, though I am pleased that our local politicians did choose to move in the correct direction. I am embarrassed to be part of the group that has allowed such things to go on for the past 22 years. We just seem to want it easy, and what I had to go through this week was anything but easy. I didn't have to make the challenge, but had I not, the same kind of things would go on for another 22 years. It seems to me that the key word is easy. We want it easy. We want our ears tickled and we want it easy. My sermon this morning grew out of an article I mysteriously stumbled upon on Friday. For me, it was mysterious, but I am sure that for the Holy Spirit, He had it very well intentioned all along. I want you to learn something this morning. I want you to grow. I want you to move from being baby Christians to mature workmen, ministers, and teachers. I want to lead people in the proper direction. This lady I saw in jail needs the truth, and it's a hard truth. We all, everyone who has accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, need to grow, and that takes the hard truth. I'm going to listen as I read this article. Much of what is published here, I have been saying and preaching for many years already. But here's the article. The end result of much of what is being done in evangelism today is about life enhancement. It's not about saving souls. People are very enthusiastic when talking about their church, pastor, or small group. It's easier to talk about religious activities rather than eternal matters, with many professing Christians, because the topic of eternal matters makes a lot of church people uncomfortable. Have you ever tried to turn the corner and move a conversation towards eternal matters and receive the deer in the headlights or please pipe down look, even from believers? The author says, I have, and I'm sure many of you have too, which isn't surprising given the fact that the emphasis of many churches is on life enhancement and not eternal salvation. The message of repentance is largely ignored and has been replaced by a different gospel. I'm sure you've heard me preach that before. That doesn't change anything at the soul level. And he's absolutely correct. Without repentance, we don't get changed at the soul level. I'm all for appreciating our churches, pastors, and ministries because there are some who still teach and preach from the foundation of God's words. These teachers, fellowships, ministries are becoming a scarce commodity these days. A growing number of churches are teaching a different gospel than Jesus taught. The growing popularity of the social gospel and seeker-sensitive movement has squelched out what has been the overarching message of Christians for the last 20 centuries. Now, I'm going to make some additions to the article, and this is me speaking. Because I want you to know what the seeker-sensitive movement is and what's going on. The seeker-sensitive or seeker-friendly church is based upon the Rick Warren model of a purpose-driven church. The Leona church just down the road has taken on this model, and it seems that for them it hasn't produced the results they were expecting as their numbers have greatly shrunk. In many ways, that was the model the Presbyterian church in Titusville took on, and that has nearly destroyed that church. The seeker-sensitive church, or seeker-friendly church, is about church growth in numbers. It is about the church modifying its behavior and message to be attractive to the seeker, or rather being seeker-sensitive. not modifying the seeker, to come into compliance with the Word of God. It is clear, it clearly is not about spiritual growth. It is not about teaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is about building numbers and mega churches full of people who are looking for self-help and not salvation. In reality, they make grace cheap. For me, I think it's about con men preaching their con, practicing their con for the purposes of making themselves rich, powerful, and influential. The messages are shallow and are geared to a grade school person, which is fine. But as Paul pointed out to the Corinthians, it is not the place where we as pastors are supposed to keep our congregations. It is not the place where the purpose-driven model never really allows for spiritual growth, because there is very little spiritual in the message. This morning, we talked about justification and sanctification, and that is a lot to take in. The belief is that culture and society has changed so much, and that the Bible has not kept pace with the needs of a changing culture and society. So therefore, the purpose of the church is to be redirected to meet the growing needs of a changing population. The fact always remains that people do not want the church dictating about sin. I find I have some of the very same problems right here in this church. Most people who want to go to church do not want to hear about the sin in their lives. All the Old Testament prophets, John the Baptist and Jesus Christ himself, based their message upon repentance. The apostles followed. You must be born again. What I find most discouraging is that I believe God was smart enough way back then to know this culture and society, and when he created the living word. Our needs are all met in the present scriptures as they were written by the hand of God. They do not need to be modified or ignored or meet some special need for this generation. That is Satan talking and directing, not God. My eyes, my mind continues to remember the tears streaming down this lady's face as I was talking with her. And to come to her with a message that is not the scripture would be a terrible sin. To try to let her be the seeker guiding the message would not bring her to repentance and salvation. And a message that teaches one can come to salvation without repentance is another gospel. Another gospel that we were warned about would come in the last days. I also find it a lie to teach people that they can come to salvation and not have to believe everything in the Bible, such as that you can be saved even if you do not believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. Or you can be saved even if you do not believe that Jesus had to die on the cross, or that there is a way to salvation other than through the blood of Jesus Christ. In this new culture, abortion and homosexuality are not sins, or even bisexuality. Sex with anyone or anything, anytime, and everywhere. I can't figure that one out, other than that's just pure sin. People, back to this article, people are sold unbiblical nonsense, such as, even if you don't believe Jesus is the Son of God, you will still have a better life if you follow his teachings. Of course, that's what the Chinese learned when they were talking about Confucius. Multitudes of people flock to these churches because they have become social hubs and religious country clubs. The prevailing message spread across many of our evangelical churches is nothing more than a life-enriching seminar neatly wrapped in a spiritual-sounding platitudes. Many of today's sermons are me-centered, spiritual-sounding pep talks that carefully avoid any aspect of God's holiness or coming judgment. This type of preaching fills thousands of seats in many churches, but it doesn't make disciples for Jesus Christ. This is not what Jesus taught and what he taught, and he spoke the words of in his life. From Matthew we read, in those days John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah when he said, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Matthew, from that time Jesus began to preach saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. In Acts, Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. From Corinthians, for godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. Repentance was the primary message Jesus taught as he began his ministry. The ministry focus on John the Baptist was squarely on repentance. The critical issue of personal repentance was at the very center of the apostolic teaching. The call to repentance has been the message that has permeated the teaching of the early church right up to the great preachers of yesterday year, such as Edwards, Spurgeon, and Tozer. The call to repent is lovingly repeated throughout the Bible, and to ignore teaching it is to ignore the central issue of God's holiness. Over the past centuries, the gospel message has remained unchanged. Men who spoke under the direction of the Holy Spirit would explain what the Bible says about God's holiness, man's sinfulness, and the utter hopelessness of the human heart apart from the saving work of Jesus Christ. In other words, unless one comes to repentance, there's no hope. The author says, my pastor breaks down the precarious eternal position of the human soul apart from Christ when he says, God is holy and we are not, and that is the problem. If preaching the whole gospel of God has been a biblical mandate from the early church until now, why do many modern preachers ignore the message of repentance? I believe it's because repentance is not seen as a relative topic that will facilitate church growth today. Many teachers are content with speaking about an invitation to a better life in lieu of the biblical message of repentance and total heart transformation through Jesus. When I see apathetic, lukewarm Christians today, I believe it is a direct result of the repentance message being largely ignored. What good does it do to know that Jesus saves if people don't see their desperate need for a Savior? When people begin to understand the true wretched condition of their sinful heart before God, they will see the need for salvation. They will see that there is no way to get to heaven apart from Jesus. They will understand even their best goodness is like filthy rags before God. This is the message that will produce godly sorrow leading to repentance. This knowledge of what the Lord has done for us should produce overwhelming joy that we aren't content to keep to ourselves. Jesus knew men's hearts, and oftentimes as the crowd swelled around him, he would say some things like, you will be hated because of my name, or you will be handed over to be persecuted. He told a crowd, repent or perish likewise. He would tell people they must put their hand to the plow and not look back, or tell them to sell everything, then follow him. Pastor James McDonald of Harvest Baptist Chapel has a great term to explain the impact of Jesus' teaching. He says, Jesus often engaged in Operation Crowd Reduction. The Lord knew for people to be his followers, they must be willing to give up everything. This message of emptying oneself and going all in for Jesus separates the true followers from the rest of the crowd. If we are to teach, preach, and disciple biblically, we must break ranks and not emulate what is being done by many leaders in the church growth movement. We need to get back to the repentance and salvation message, because that is what people need in these days. Instead of spiritual apathy and Christians who are simply going through the religious motions, we will have people who truly understand and live the joy of their salvation through Jesus. Nothing cuts through apathetic Christianity more than a powerful testimony about salvation. The author says, I recently watched a video that shows what happens when the gospel and the need to repent is preached. The mini documentary tells the story of a remote tribe of people in Papua New Guinea hearing the gospel and how they responded with repentance, humility, and uninhibited joy. As I watched the video, I realized why these people were responding with so much joy and repentance in their testimonies. It is because they heard the whole gospel and knew that without Jesus, they were eternally lost. These people came face to face with the absolute necessity of repentance. What would happen if that biblical truth was preached instead of me-centered messages that are so pervasive today? We would be making disciples instead of producing numbers, and we would be fired up soul winners instead of widespread apathy. If we teach the biblical message of repentance, church growth will be attained the way God intended it to be. Because the Bible tells us that the Lord says that he will add to our numbers day by day those who were being saved. As we draw near to the time of Jesus' return, the Bible tells us that apostate teachings will creep into the church. As believers, we must be ready to tell people the good news. The need for people to repent is central in the message. It produces humility and glorifies God. Repentance may not be the popular message in today's evangelical circles, but is one that transforms hearts and makes disciples. That's the end of the article. And that is why we must preach and teach about sin. If we don't preach and teach about sin, how can there be repentance? Repentance from what? If I don't grow this church or grow you, what have I done for you? Our hymn of dedication this morning is Seek Ye First.
Kingdom of God and
Madison and Abby, would you come to take our offering, please? Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for each and every person. We thank you for the ears that are open and listen. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the struggle of our Savior Jesus Christ and all of the apostles to bring us the word. Help us to be the church we need to be. Help us to be good stewards of all that we have. Your word, the message, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the money that comes in, the people's talents, helps, and everything that we need to keep this church growing and functioning. Thank you for each and every person that provides so much here at the church and all the work that everyone does. We ask you to continue to watch over our children and be with each and every person here, to keep your hand upon each and every person, to watch over them and guide them this week, to keep them safe and happy and healthy and strong, to keep all evil and all other things away, to watch over their homes and their cars, their comings and their goings, and all the things that they do. We ask you to be with all of those, all of our kids and all of those who are providing care for them, that the care that's being provided will be to your glory. Help us each to have the opportunity to witness to someone this week, to invite someone to church, to spread the gospel, to tell someone that they can change, that God can forgive, that they can have a new life. Help us be what we need to be, to make the tough steps. For we ask all of these things in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.